Good morning. Hi, Mark. How are you?
Good, thank you, sir. Yourself?
Good.
Glad to hear it. No, you didn't.
I mean, yeah. It's the same conversation over the same thing, you know?
Yes.
It's like a universal.
Yes, it really is.
I
All who are able, please rise and join me in the call to worship as printed in your bulletin. We enter the sanctuary dreaming Mary's dream, seeking the blessing that arrives at rest, as sit down and stay a while, as nobody is disposable, as do what you need, we got you. We gather together, yearning Martha's yearning, needing the blessing that drenches us in relief, in here, let me help, in we move together, in take a deep breath, we got you. We come to worship loving Jesus' love, creating the blessing that stretches out as solidarity, as nothing about us without us, as access is love, as you are not alone, we got you. Through our praise and our prayers, in our songs and our sighs, let us be prepared to be living sanctuaries, unique embodiments of God's love and justice.
Continue in the spirit of worship, I invite us into a time of centering using a breath prayer. A breath prayer is an ancient form of prayer that invites you to breathe in with a phrase in mind and breathe out with a phrase in mind. This particular breath prayer comes from Cole Arthur Riley, who has created a project called Black Liturgies on Instagram, and this is one of her liturgies that she offers to people to pray alongside and in solidarity with African American communities. So I invite us to be in that spirit of solidarity, to take some breaths. And as you inhale, say to yourself, I can honor what I need. And as you exhale, my boundaries are holy. Inhale, I can honor what I need. Exhale, my boundaries are holy. I can honor what I need. My boundaries are holy. I can honor what I need. My boundaries are holy. Amen.
Filled with that sacred breath, we are invited to live into the light of God's shalom, to seek the well-being and the wholeness of all creation. Peace for our bodies, peace for our souls, peace in our relationships, peace in our world. May the peace of Christ be with you and also with you. We'll take a moment to share this peace with one another. You may wish to do so by remaining in your pews and simply bowing or making a gesture of eye contact with one another, or if you feel comfortable to move about the sanctuary, just being mindful of social distance with one another. Let us share the peace of Christ.
You know.
Welcome, beloveds. Welcome to the First Congregational Church of Alameda. We welcome each other this morning as we do every time that we gather, bringing all of who we are into this space, whatever that means for us today, saying no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. Thank you for gathering in this space today, whether you're worshiping in the sanctuary or online. It's a joy to be connected to one another in praise and in love of God and fellowship today. I want to welcome some visitors, Catherine and Molly. Welcome. We hope today is nourishing for you. And our guest preacher, Dr. Sharon Fennema. There's a fuller bio in the bulletin, but Sharon works for the national setting of our denomination, the United Church of Christ, as the curator for Join the Movement Towards Racial Justice. So take a moment and talk with Sharon sometime about that. I also, Sharon is my partner, so it's a special day when we get to lead worship together. So thank you for being with us today, Sharon. For folks, just so you know, there are worship materials in the back in the narthex for children of all ages. So if you find that working on some prayer beads or coloring helps you connect to worship more fully, please help yourself to that station at any point throughout worship. And I want to share, yesterday was Relay for Life, and our youth group and other members of the congregation were out there all day from 1 until 10 o'clock. So feeling good in spirit, a little tired in body today, but our goal fundraising was $3,000, and this was an ambitious goal for our team, and I'm excited to share that as of today, we have raised $4,226. So thank you to all who donated, who helped organize, who brought us lovely food, who came out in support of Relay. It was a wonderful gathering to be with the community yesterday. And now I want to invite anybody who's feeling young at heart to come up. If you're comfortable, I have a storybook to share with us today. Hi, friends. I might remain standing just so I can help show everybody. So in a little bit, Sharon, our preacher, is going to look at the scripture story from a lens of disability justice. So I thought, just to help us understand more fully what that could look like for our community and our lives, I'd shared this book. This is a storybook called We Move Together. And we'll just see what we can learn about how we can support one another from this book. So this is, I'm just going to read this opening. This might just help us get a greater sense of what disability justice can mean. All bodies are unique and essential. All bodies are whole. All bodies have strength and needs that must be met. We are powerful not despite the complexities of our bodies, but because of them. We move together with nobody left behind. This is disability justice. And those are the words from Aurora Levens Morales and Patty Byrne. So we've got a bunch of kids playing in lots of different ways. And it says, we move together. We move fast. We move slow. We move together. Maybe everybody can say that with me. We move together. Sometimes we have to wait. And in this scene, we just have somebody waiting in a wheelchair to get onto a bus, so they're waiting for the ramp to come down. Waiting can feel boring, frustrating, hard. Waiting can also feel exciting. Like butterflies, like love. And now everybody's on the bus. We wait so we can spend time together. Sometimes when we're together, we get stopped in our tracks. Does anybody have a sense of what's happening in this scene? Oh, they might be distracted by the cat. Yeah, there's a woman in a chair and she can't get into the ice cream shop because there's no ramp. There's a stair in the way. Like when all the fun and the flavors of ice cream are just one step out of reach. We notice when things are unfair and it helps us get creative. And in this scene, what's happening here? Yeah, a whole community is coming together and building really colorful ramps. So we can make plans and we can solve problems. And we can build something better. And now all the stores on the road have ramps. We work together. Kids and dogs, bodies and machines, bees and flowers, fish and water. Relying on each other helps us get where we need to go. Sometimes we find ourselves in unfamiliar spaces. We wonder, we get curious. And here there's a family in an art gallery, and there are some folks talking in sign language with one another. And one of the kids seems kind of curious about this new language. We might have more questions than answers. Our questions can help us learn to do things differently. And discover new ways of understanding each other. For all the things that connect us are also what nourish us, like roots and tubes and straws and friends. And the things that connect us are often what challenge us. Sometimes we disagree about how to be together. Have we ever disagreed about how to be together? Yeah. Solving one problem can create another, and we don't always know how to make things better. Sometimes we need to take a break. Even when we're by ourselves, we never move alone. And this image has an image of one of our friends surrounded by different ancestors, different people who've come before them. Like feeling so close with someone who's far, like learning from others who have come before. Their memories can ground us, soothe us, and move us. And you all might recognize this image. This is on the cover of your bulletin. Whether we're by ourselves or surrounded by many, our small movements can turn into big movements. We celebrate, we make change. We move together. And if this is a book, I'll leave this up on the altar. you want to see it after worship, there are also some helpful resources in the back to learn more. So I just wanted to share that just to help open our imagination about how we can all more fully move together with one another. So we'll keep praying about that throughout this worship service. So let's just take a moment to pray with one another. Gracious God, God of all bodies, all experiences, thank you for this sacred life that we get to share with one another and with you. Open our hearts to all the ways that we can move together as your community. In all of your holy names, and in the name of your beloved Jesus, we pray. Amen. Thanks, friends. Thanks.
The song, "The Master of the Sheepfold," is a combination of all the scriptures in John 10, the 10th chapter of John, where it talks about the shepherd and the sheep. In many ways, it's another parable, but it's also a metaphor of inclusiveness. And I want you to understand that the metaphor of the hireling is one of inhumanity, of exclusivity, of not caring, as just opposed to the good shepherd, who is the radical, inclusive person, the master of the sheepfold. My sheep, did you bring them all in? And he calls to his hireling shepherd, my sheep, did you bring them all in? Oh, the master guards the sheepfold, and he wants to know, are my sheep brought in? And he's calling, calling, calling softly, softly calling for them all to come a-gathering in. Then the hireling shepherd answers, there's some that's weak and thin, there's some that's got all wettered, and they can't go home again. They're lost and good for nothing, but the rest, they're all brought in. They're lost and good for nothing, but the rest, they're all brought in. Oh, the master guards the sheepfold, and he wants to know, are my sheep brought in? And he's calling, calling, calling softly, softly calling for them all to come a-gathering in. Then the master of the sheepfold, who guards the sheepfold bin, goes out in the gloom and rain path, where the long night's rains begin. And he lets down the bars of the sheepfold, calling soft, come in, come in. And he lets down the bars of the sheepfold, calling soft, come in, come in. Oh, the master. master guards the sheepfold, and he wants to know, are my sheep brought in? And he's calling, calling, calling softly, softly calling for them all to come a-gathering in. From the gloom and meadows, through the long night's rain and in, up from the gloom and rain path, where the long night's rains begin, come the poor lost sheep of the sheepfold, they all come a-gathering in. Come the poor lost sheep of the sheepfold, they all come a-gathering in. Oh, the master guards the sheepfold, and he wants to know, are my sheep brought in? And he's calling, calling, calling softly, softly calling for them all to come a-gathering in.
Thank you, Russell. This morning's reading is taken from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 10, verses 38 through 42. Let us listen for the voice of God who is still speaking. Now, as they went on their way, he entered a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him. She had a sister named Mary who sat at Jesus' feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks, so she came to him and asked, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me." But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things, but few things are needed, indeed only one. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her." Here ends the scripture reading. May it bear fruit in our lives.
I feel like I have to start this sermon by admitting to you all that I really struggle with this passage from Luke. I've never been able to loosen it from the way I heard it preached for much of my life, where it was used to pit Mary against Martha and laud Mary as the true disciple because she sat and listened to Jesus. Somehow, preachers always manage to denigrate the care work and hospitality that Martha was providing as lesser, less holy, less Jesus-y, less faithful, just like our patriarchal society has done and continues to do. And these same sermons often became an opportunity to celebrate the contemplative, thinking, reflective life of faith over the active, practiced, embodied life of faith. Spiritual versus practical, theological versus embodied, replicating dichotomies that have often served the oppressive power of white supremacy, imperialism, and patriarchy. Frankly, I just really get annoyed with Jesus here. I mean, sure, eat Martha's food, enjoy her hospitality, and then tell her Mary is actually doing it right. Come on, Jesus, really? So I'm exceedingly grateful that in its strange and sometimes spirit-filled wisdom, the Revised Common Lectionary assigned this text during the month of July this year, which also happens to be Disability Pride Month. This month-long celebration was initially a celebration of the passing of the Americans with Disabilities Act in July 1990, and has grown to be an opportunity to celebrate disabled people, our identities and culture, and our contributions to society. It also seeks to change the way people think about and define disability, to end the stigma of disability, and to promote the understanding that disability is a natural part of human diversity in which people living with disabilities can take pride. The convergence of this story from the Gospel of Luke and Disability Pride Month pointed me toward disability justice as a lens for dialogue with this scripture. Disability justice invites us to change our thinking from imagining disability as a lack to understanding disability as holding wisdom, experience, and insight that can transform our world and move us toward becoming a more just and loving society. Considering this story from Luke by centering disability justice as our interpretive lens got me to thinking, what if Mary was choosing what was right for her body that day? What if sitting and listening was the gift that she could offer in that moment? What if that day was a pain flare-up day, and what she really needed was a place to be tender with her aching bones? What if Mary simply didn't have the spoons to do what Martha was doing that day? Now, if you're not familiar with the term spoons, here's how Leah Lakshmi Pyepsna Samaran Sinha describes it in her amazing book, Care Work, Dreaming Disability Justice. Spoons, she says, is slang created by sick and disabled communities to describe units of energy and capacity, specifically within a sick and disabled context of having a limited amount of energy because of chronic illness or disability, and thus having to make decisions about which tasks to do and which to let slide. The concept was created by Christine Miseridano in her essay, The Spoon Theory, in which a chronically ill woman attempting to describe what it is like to live with chronic illness pulls out a handful of spoons and uses them to represent units of energy, relating what it's like to have to carefully count how much energy you can expend on daily tasks many able people take for granted. So what if sitting and listening is what Mary had spoons for? As I was reading and rereading this passage from Luke, I could not help but think about the letter that Leah includes in her book, Care Work. It's entitled, So Much Time in Bed. In it, she recounts how her chronic illness requires stretches of rest, of time spent in bed, which also happens to be where she does most of her creative work and writing. She writes, chronic illness sucks, but oh, there is the secret bliss of bed. It is so difficult to write both about what is horrible about disability, the pain, the oppression, the impairment, and the joy of this body at the same time. The joy of this body comes most of all in the hard beauty of this life built around all the time I must spend resting. Chronic illness may not have made me a writer, but it illuminates my writing life, she says. I can't work a 9-to-5, but bedtime means dream time, creative time, time to sift through and find what is speaking. The bed is the in-between place of opening. I wonder if this is close to what Mary experienced as she sat and listened not only to Jesus, but to her own body. I imagine her wanting to be present, to connect with community that her family was building and that surrounded Jesus, but determining in what ways she could be present. I see her weighing her capacity, assessing what she has spoons for. If I help with the food, I won't have enough energy to be present to the conversation later. If I offer hospitality, I'll be in too much pain to listen. So she chooses the in-between place at Jesus' feet to sit and be present to what will open to her. She too finds beauty in the needed rest time and time to sift through and find what is speaking. Using a disability justice lens makes me wonder if it is precisely the wisdom of Mary's limits that empowers her to be in collaborative relationship with Jesus, leaning into the new world he is imagining with his followers. When I read the story in this way, it also changes how I encounter Martha. Through a disability justice lens, I recognize in Martha the many voices of ableist, racialized capitalism. Our society tells us a very particular stories about whose bodies, lives, and ways of being in the world are valuable, about whose lives matter. When Martha asks Jesus to help, tell Mary to help her, I hear capitalism saying, "You don't look sick. Why don't you stop being lazy and contribute something of value?" In her letter, Leah describes these voices this way. Capitalism says that disabled, tired bodies that spend too much time in bed are useless. People are valued for the wealth they labor to build for capitalism. Crips are useless to capitalism. The same system that supports the logic of slavery and created racialized inferiority in order to justify the exploitation of black bodies, that same system of capitalism understands sick and disabled bodies as disposable, inherently unvalued and unvaluable. Martha speaks from and for that system when she wants to steal Mary's rest, to tell her what she should be doing, and to get others to be accomplices in her correcting Mary. Martha is asking Jesus to do the dirty work of ableist racialized capitalism, deny Mary her boundaries and the wisdom of her limits, and remind her that her worth comes only through being useful. My heart breaks a little when I feel Martha's scarcity in this story. I want to call her in. I want to say to her, you don't have to respond to your overwhelm in this way. This is not a zero-sum game. We can work toward a liberation that means we all get what we need. You don't have to take Mary down a peg to get your needs met. And you don't have to try to get others to do that too. You don't have to be limitless, Martha, to be worthy. You can have boundaries and needs too. I want to whisper the words of disability justice activist Patty Byrne in her ear. All bodies are unique and essential, and all bodies have strengths and needs that must be met. And I wish that was what Jesus had said to her, instead of seemingly taking sides. But this framework helps me understand Jesus' words a bit differently too. Perhaps Jesus is offering us a model of able-bodied solidarity. He affirms Mary's choice. He honors her decision about what's best for her body. He refuses to be made an accomplice to ableist racialized capitalism. He doesn't assume he knows what's right for her. And he centers her experience as the one who knows best how to resist these systems, as the one who's most impacted by them. And he's willing to stake his reputation, to use his power, to ensure that she continues to be able to do what is best for her body, mind, and spirit. When Jesus says, Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her, I hear him saying, your rest will not be taken away from you. Your bodily autonomy will not be taken away from you. Your ability to choose and consent to how your body is treated will not be taken away from you. Your boundaries will not be taken away from you. Your sacred affirmation of your limits will not be taken away from you. Your access will not be taken away from you. Your need for slowness and spaciousness will not be taken away from you. Your disabled wisdom will not be taken away from you. Your knowledge of what you need will not be taken away from you. The beauty of your life built around resting will not be taken away from you. I wonder if the Spirit-filled life we are being invited to imagine by the story in the Gospel of Luke during this Disability Pride Month is a life that looks for the wisdom emerging from our limits. What gifts might we, like Mary, find in our limitedness? What opens up to us in the in-between space of rest? What might our bodies be showing us of God's kingdom when we recognize that all bodies are unique and essential, and all bodies have strengths and needs that must be met, including our own? Perhaps this story is also inviting us to do some soul searching about the ways that the voices of ableist, racialized capitalism live in us. How do our decisions reflect whose lives we see as valuable? When do we make judgments about what others can or should be doing? When do we make able-bodied assumptions about what others are capable of? And where do we turn these voices against ourselves, telling ourselves that we are only worthy if we are of use, that we are only valuable when we are producing something or contributing something? How do we denigrate our own limits and boundaries as failures or faults and minimize our own needs? Maybe our encounter with Martha and Mary this Disability Pride Month is Jesus' invitation to all of us to choose this better part, to choose to embody the values and practices of claiming, as Leah puts it, this body broken beautiful, not a liability, but a gift. Amen.
As we come to our time of community prayer, I just invite us to find a place of stillness and rest in our bodies, whatever that might look and feel like to you today. And just take a deep breath. God, our Creator, we gather in this space, with you now, with one another, bringing all that our bodies carry, all of the wisdom and experiences and yearnings, the hopes and challenges, the limits and boundaries. We gather all of that here, remembering that all of that is sacred. All of who we are is sacred. And we lift up the prayers to you of this community. We ask especially for prayers of hope for those dealing with the fires near Yosemite, for the evacuees, the firefighters, and the volunteers. May they get out safe and soon. We lift up all communities impacted by fires and by climate crisis. Open our hearts to find a way that the ways that we can change this course and honor the sacredness of the body of this earth. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We ask for prayers of grace for our wider church community in the Northern California Nevada Conference of the UCC. As two of our conference ministers, Reverend Diane and Reverend Daniel, transition from their ministry roles. Gracious God, may the ministries they have inspired be affirmed and celebrated in this time. And may this transition be a blessing to the church and to each of them. God, in your grace, hear our prayers. We ask for continued prayers of support for Jordana as she begins new rounds of medical treatment. Compassionate God, may a tender place for healing and rest be prepared for her in the days ahead. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for the family of Vince, who is 65, a friend of 30 years who died of a heart attack a week ago Wednesday. His children used to play with Mark and Carolyn's children, and he will be sorely missed. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We ask for prayers for all of those who are suffering from poverty, hunger, homelessness, grief, depression, and anxiety. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And we lift up prayers of gratitude for all of the communities here and around the world who gathered for Relay of Life, bringing together hope and cures and memories and grief, that this space of community is prepared, and that as we move together, we find new ways forward. God, in your grace, hear our prayers. And God, we lift up prayers of gratitude for each of our unique bodies, for each of our callings, for the journey that is ahead of each of us and that connects us. May we honor one another's limits, offer each other a place of rest, and be a home for you. God, in your grace, hear our prayers. We lift up all of these prayers, those that have been spoken aloud, and those that dwell deep within our bodies and souls. We lift them to you now, saying the prayer that your beloved Jesus taught us. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. As we come to our time of offering, we are invited to bring the gifts of who we are, of what we can offer in this moment. So perhaps it's a time for you to reflect on how you are being called to be with God in this community, in this time, to offer financial gifts in whatever way you feel moved, to offer any other prayers. How are you being called to give of yourself this morning? May the ushers please come forward.
As I was leaving Dottie Allen's first grade class, she handed me a poem by Ivy Eastman about Thanksgiving. And she asked me to put a tune to it, and I did. And this is that tune, and it is for early grade school children, but it has ramifications for us as well. Thank you for all my hands can hold, apples red and melons gold, yellow corn both ripe and sweet, peas and beans so good to eat. Thank you for all my eyes can see, lovely sunlight, field and tree, white cloud boats in a sea deep sky, soaring birds and butterfly. Thank you for all my hands can hold, apples red and melons gold, yellow corn both ripe and sweet, peas and beans so good to eat. Thank you for all my ears can hear, birdsong echoing far and near, songs of little stream, big sea, cricket, bullfrog, duck and bee. Thank you for all my hands can hold, apples red and melons gold, yellow corn both ripe and sweet, peas and beans so good to eat.
If you feel moved, I invite you to extend a hand in blessing towards our offering. Gracious God, we offer you our rest, our gifts, our very being, so that we might move together more fully into your love and justice, your kingdom here on earth. May it be so this day, now and always. Amen.
Just
beloved ones of the Holy One, as you journey forth from this place, may the same blessing Jesus offered Mary and Martha surround you. May your rest not be taken away from you. May your boundaries not be taken away from you. May your sacred affirmation of your limits not be taken away from you. And may the Spirit who lives and moves within and among us fill each breath with the blessed assurance that all bodies are unique and essential, and all bodies and have strengths and needs that must be met. Go in peace and celebrate that we are powerful not despite the complexities of our bodies, but because of them. Amen.